Morning, everybody. I'm sure before I give my address, Mr. Nagesh, the chairman of Retail Association of India, Mr. Rajgopalan, CEO Retail Association of India, James from the Sector Skill Council, board members of retailers and other participants. Well, thank you very much to be with you, and I believe you all have been on with the deliberation since yesterday, and you will wind up this afternoon if I'm not mistaken. Well, when I address you, I wonder, because you have been in the scheme of things much before I came in, and where do I figure in all this is a big question which most of you must be wondering, that in a segment which is almost 99.9% private, where does the government figure in? And I think this is the question being raised in most of the sectors when we are talking about the government getting into the, in some particular way. Well, as far as the Sector Skill Council or my involvement is concerned, it's almost a negligible interference or intervention into what actually you have been doing for years. In history, this activity, what you are doing, has been performed maybe good 5,000 years or 4,000 years ago. Except that they went in boats, they went in ships, half of them drowned when they were crossing the seas. Countries were invaded, and it all started when they started retailing and merchandise. So you have a very long history, but then they didn't wear suits, they didn't have laptops, they didn't have these modern amenities which could have made their work faster. But nonetheless, you are in a profession which has a history, or maybe directly or indirectly you're employing people who have been retailing or marketing themselves over centuries. Well, I'd just like to flag the issues which matter the most today. And when I'm here, the Prime Minister thought in his vision to create a separate ministry called Ministry for Skill Development and Entrepreneurship. I'm with the entrepreneurs of the day. I'm with the other big lot, which needs a lot of, it's a huge manpower to run the retail sector. And amid several deliberations which you must have had, there must be, and if I am correct, by 2022 we require 10 million people who have to be trained in the retail sector, if I'm correct with the figures. Now, if I talk about this particular figure, it does not mean individually. For this, the economy has also to grow at a rate of around 7 to 8%. So it's a back-to-back situation. We presume that this government would be able to take the growth to good 7 to 8%, which possibly would trigger off the requirement, the trigger of the retail sector, trade and retail along with it, and subsequently would require this manpower. Well, this ministry was born the day I was inducted in the Union Council of Ministers. It's about 70 or maybe 80 days, 9th of November, 2014. Actually, it all started in 2009 when there was a national skill development policy which was initiated in this country in the previous government. In 2009, a policy was made. We are almost 5 years under that policy and needs to be reviewed. And this particular department existed under the Ministry of Economic Affairs as a part of the Economic Affairs Department. Subsequently, the Planning Commission had something to do with it. And from the Planning Commission, when Mr. Modi's government was formed, it was moved as a department of sports, youth affairs and sports. It still didn't work good, and the Prime Minister thought that much has to be done in this sector. Well, this is not my forte. Actually, this is a domain, and this ministry was created, independent charge was given to me on 9th of November. And actually, when I got into this ministry, there was a parliament session which started on the 22nd of November. And I look after parliamentary affairs as well. I didn't have an office. Usually to feel like government, you need files to be routed to you, files coming to you. I didn't have a file. I didn't have computer. I was using my own laptop. I was running my office in my laptop bag. But that possibly would have happened in the history of India, that a union minister would be running an office from a laptop in his office. I just started from nothing. But if I have to flag what I started with and where I want to reach, it will rather put you in a situation which possibly could be the biggest enterprise ever taken up in the world, in any country's history, is my assignment. And I'll come back to it, how and what I mean by it. So in the parliament session, when there were questions in parliament, there were 22 ministers answering the questions on skill development, except the minister for skill development. And the government of India would spend about 7,000 crores. So every minister, I would say, they would. This has been a problem for last 3 months. Wherever I walk in, wherever I go, I just walked in and I was walking past, and I was only scared that someone will come across to me and say, "Sir, I want a minute," and I know what he's going to talk. It sounds slightly impolite to say that everyone knows about skill development except the skill development minister, because there's so much domain knowledge and everyone wants to catch your hand and say, "Boss, can you have a minute? I want to tell you what great things I'm doing." Actually, it reflects a point. Much before I came in, many people were doing this and doing this in a big way. But actually doing it how, where, under what precision is a big question. And every airport, maybe in small gatherings in the evening. So I've been taught in last 3 months how to run the Ministry of Skill Development. Possibly no minister in Government of India would have been taught so much as I have been taught. And I still continue to do so. And I'm sure after this, some of you would certainly like to seek an appointment. And I've made it very easy. My name is R. Rajiv Pratap Rudy. So I have put it rprudy.appointment@gmail.com. Anyone wants to an appointment as skill development comes on that. But I have improved upon it. There is one rprudy.presentation@gmail.com, because most of them would not be happy with an appointment. They want to give a presentation. So I have made it more easy, because I was finding it very difficult to differentiate between an appointment and a presentation. So in case any one of you want to come back to me for a presentation, send a presentation copy along so that I can slot it, because first people meet to suggest that they want to give a presentation, and second time they come with a presentation. So I have clubbed it together to make it easy. But that's not all. So if I get back to the issues which I was talking about on the policy level, where do we stand? And what are we talking about? This country, when we talk, is a country with a population of 1,260 million people. And if we club it with China, I must say that every fifth and sixth individual trotting on the globe is an Indian or a Chinese. So between us and China, rest of the world is one side and we are on the one side. So when we're talking about 1,260 million people, we are also talking about a good 500 million people working in the unorganized sector. And if you're talking in the unorganized sector, I'm not talking about the farm sector. I just leave the farm sector alone, absolutely. I have nothing to do with the farm sector, assuming that I have nothing to do as this point of time, but a lot of work has to be done there. Then 54% people are in the farm sector. I'm left with around good 250 million people who have to be addressed as far as skill development in the unorganized sector is concerned. And assuming that today, it's a fact, it's a figure, an SSO figure, that 30 million people are there in the organized workforce, which means paramilitary forces, armed forces, government, state governments. And another 10 million would be in the organized sector, people like you who draw their salary from a bank. So that takes away 40 million people. So I'm left with another 210 million people. And if I have to add another 10 million people every year for next 5 years, I have come back to another 250 million people. So 25 crore people have to be addressed in next 5 years. That means 5 crore people have to be addressed each year, which means 50 million people have to be addressed every year. But it's not a small figure. That would be the size of more than 100 countries across the world. And this is the challenge where we begin with. Now, how do we go about it? because all this would require huge resources. And the NSDA, which is a partner of the government in Delhi, has virtually assessed that we require about, at an average, with capex and interest and everything involved, about 20,000 rupees to a head to train an individual. So good 30 crores, and assuming that 30% are capable of paying for themselves, I come back to the figure of around 25 crore people who have to be trained. So 20,000 into 25 crore would be 5 lakh crores required in the next 5 years. Well, we started very late. Actually, we have started very, very late. And why I say we have started very late is some figures which would rattle you. In a country like United States of America, almost 45% of the workforce is skilled. Even in China today, which has about 1.4 billion people, good 40% of the workforce is skilled. Japan, about 80% of the workforce is skilled. Germany, about 74% of the workforce is skilled. Korea, 96% of the workforce is skilled. What about India? Only 2% of the workforce is skilled. And that is where we start. So keeping that in mind, how do we do it? Because I find almost everyone, in the last 3 months I have assessed, it's not a rocket science. It's not a science of putting your craft on the Mars. It's a very simple science which needs to be addressed. But what we have been doing in the last 55, 60 years is we have been educating people. So we're spending about 2 lakh crores annually on educating people. All of us are a product of that. But unfortunately, our education system, which had its own limitations, did never address the issue of skill development. I'm not talking about cognitive skills. I'm talking about the non-cognitive skill part. Even in the cognitive skills, which should have developed from primary to the secondary level, has actually never started in this country. Yes, some modern schools, some facilities, some Jesuit institutions, some philanthropic organizations did talk about cognitive skills. But most of our government system never talked about cognitive skills. Forget about the non-cognitive skills. So that is the place where we start now. And there could be many more figures to convince how the education system has not been able to deliver what they should have delivered. Now, looking into all this, we need to address and train so many people. And if I had some time to make a presentation, I would have shown you how the demand in various sectors. In infrastructure alone, we require about 100 million people. In real estates, we'll require about 33 million people. Healthcare, we require about good 15 million people. And the whole figures goes down to about good 30 crore. So actually, there is a demand of 30 crore people. There is a workforce of 30 crore people. And what we have to do is to match this demand, put resources, and train these people to create the largest workforce in the world. So it sounds big, it sounds humongous, it sounds as if it's unachievable, but I must say that one man who is passionately talking about skill development is the Prime Minister, who knows the strength involved for the economy to grow is skill development. Without skills, Make in India can't happen. Without skills, Swachh Bharat can't happen. Without skills, banking system and Jan Dhan Yojana cannot be functionalized. Every human resource has to be skilled. And I can tell you a very, very small example. I was there yesterday in Ahmedabad. And I'm still not talking about entrepreneurship. I've just left that chapter. I'm talking about skill. There was a man who, and I was so amazed that he earns 25,000 rupees because he has become a sub-agent of the State Bank of India. ISEC is one organization. And he keeps his shop or his counter open from 7 o'clock in the morning till 9 o'clock in the evening, employs 4 young girls. He makes deposits there. He's connected to the State Bank of India. He issues passbooks. He issues credit cards. He deposits money and he gives out money. to the tune of 10,000 rupees, which is a maximum withdrawal. And he earns about 25,000 rupees because State Bank pays him. You see, if there are, say, 10,000 or 50,000 such small places across the country, the banks stop their collection at 4 o'clock or maybe 3 o'clock, 3:30. This man works for the bank till 8 o'clock, 9 o'clock. People were pouring in with 50 rupees, 100 rupees, 150 rupees, and actually checked out. It was not big amounts. But more than 4 to 5 crores get deposited in that particular bank after the banking time is over. You see, these are the possibilities which we have not explored. There could be many more. I went to visited the blind school there. And in the blind school, I have asked them to prepare a video clip. You're talking about retailing? They were actually plumbers being trained. They were fitting wash basins. They were cutting pipes. They were fitting showers, practicing. They were actually plumbing the whole toilet, and they were all blind. Can you believe a plumber who was blind comes to your house? And I asked him, how do you know the measurements? I said, how do you know the measurements? How do you cut the pipe? How do you know the thickness of that pipe? He says, he showed me, there was all written on a braille, the measurements and all. We are absolutely nowhere. The people who can't speak, the people who can't see, they are getting the skills of participating. The whole 400 million people we are talking about are much better off. And that's where we start. But unfortunately, James gave me a report. Yours is one of the most challenging sectors. I think you are smart. You have to market yourself and your goods and your retail and your shop, and everything has to be smart. You see, I would be the only parliamentarian on the globe which actually flies big jets. I'm a captain with Indigo Airlines. I do not know anyone has flown with me or not. Oh, there are so many people who have been my passengers. So I do. And you see, I come from the state of Bihar. Possibly none of you would be able to connect. Did anyone connect that I come from Bihar? Very difficult, except that who may be from Bihar. And do you know whom I contest? I contest Lalu Prasad Yadav. So I'm a recipe. Please do not get into what I talk here. I'm a recipe of real politics. I'm a recipe of real politics. But I understand what has to be done here as well. So I have no problems as far as connecting to you and connecting to those 1.5 million people I represent. I'm the most comfortable and I'm the most popular. It's different. Lalu Prasad Yadav could not contest this time because he's convicted and his wife, but nonetheless, both are the same. No, I have no offense meant, but the style of politics, and I'm talking about. It's not that I'm not anything against it, that she's a very respectable lady. I have nothing to talk about any lady, but I said the type of politics. So I'm a recipe of that 1.5 million people I represent. And you see, I fortunately could get an education in school where I can speak as I am speaking. I can speak Hindi, I can speak Bhojpuri. But many who did not have the privilege of doing this. And Indigo Airlines, they have a system of employing girls who come as air hostesses. Bihar has a population of about 100 million, 10 crore people. Uttar Pradesh has about 20 crores, 200 million people, 300 million people. And they have an open site where they invite every location for interviewing employment. They just announce, all the employees suggest. And out of every 100 girls selected, maybe one or two would be from Bihar and Uttar Pradesh. Rest 98 would be from the rest of the country. Do you know why? They are not that they are not intelligent, that they are not sharp, that they can't look after themselves. They just don't have a QP. And when we talk about the Sector Skill Council, we talk about the qualification packs and the job rules. So simply they're not groomed. The hairstyle could not be very impressive. The way they walk into the interview, they are not appreciated. And when they open their mouth, none of you like them because they can't speak English. And these skills, clubbed with their competency of 5 months or 2 months of grooming can make them, they could be very good in maths, they could be very good in physics, they could be very good in computers, but the personality grooming, which requires a 3 month effort, is not with them, and they become, with all their qualifications, unemployable. What we need to do is first phase, the Prime Minister has always talked, that let's groom an individual. Anyone getting skilled must have some basic soft skills. They must certainly have a personality, hygiene, how to take care of yourselves, how to groom yourself, how to look clean, how to wear good, how to, because every time I walk in and I'll catch a person by the shoes, if a small retail shop, it could be a very old shoe. But be like the Britishers, even if it's an old shoe, if you polish it, you look like a gentleman. I do not know how many of you, when you see the young boys in this retail shop, ask them to polish their shoes or provide a shoe polishing point. It makes all of difference. Wearing in a slippers and wearing a laces makes all the difference in your smartness. Try wearing slip-ons and tomorrow you try to wear a shoe with laces. You'll find a difference in yourself. And that is how we have to start checking out and grooming individuals. I'm not talking about huge investment. The retail sector can pick up but one thing which all of you have to do is, what is a sector skill council? We have had a lot of confederations. You have the retail sector of India. But the Sector Skill Council is a non-governmental effort in which the industry creates a syllabus and the course of training which are certified by the industry to be make an individual employable. So this is a part of the government, a flexible system of sector skill councils under the National Skill Development Corporation. For example, you must be hearing about welding. Everyone knows about welding. I'm sure everyone knows about welding. But when you're talking about a welding in an assembly line of Hyundai Motors, a man at the spot has to do 6 touches to a welding on the chassis of the car in 2 minutes in precision. So his job of a welder is different. So he does 6 points of welding in exactly 2 minutes and the assembly line, the car moves on. If he fails to do that, the whole assembly line stops. So that is 1 degree of precision. He's also a welder. The second category of welder could be a person who works in oil and pipe gas lines. So he's also a welder, but his torch is different. His training is different. Gas lines are different. And there could be a third category of a welder who is in the oil rig, who is also a diver, goes deep inside the rig, and there he does the welding. He's also a welder. But most of us cannot distinguish between a welder. And if I have to give one more example, Peru, South American state, does anyone have an idea how far is it? Wild guess, somewhat, how many kilometers away? Good 15,000 kilometers away from here. The embassy in Peru panicked and sent a letter to us saying, every month or so I'm issuing 50 visas being asked by Indian companies for appointment of drill hole operators, loaders, dumpers, forklift operators. People are coming from 15,000 kilometers away to work in Delhi and Jaipur as forklift operators. Is it not shocking? And we back here, and when the Prime Minister says we need all this to be done here, when we need a small amount of English, when we need a small amount of grooming, when we need a small amount of training to make you not only the resource of the country, but internationally. I can keep telling you many more examples. I just don't want to take your time. But in the retail sector, when we already have the Retail Sector Skill Council, and I believe Rai has associated with the retail, and you have just set up 4 QPs, James? 6. 6 qualification packs, which could be the smallest in all the industry I'm handling. I just had a delegation visiting from South Australia. The minister of South Australia, not Australia, and the population of that state is 1.2 million, less than the size of my parliamentary constituency. In that the skill development ministry had 1300 QPs for the state of 1.2 million people, 1300. The sector skill council all got together, we have around 1,990 QPs which have been created. China would be around good, I do not know, 40,000, 30,000, I would not know, I don't know the figure. But my point is, I read through the report, all an activity is there. But as long as all of you do not, in the, as an industry, recognize that the sector skill council, and if tomorrow, I've just seen about the number of people who are here, who would actually recognize the, what is a sector skill council, creates a syllabus, the QPs, then you have a system of assessment, then you have your training providers, then you have a system of assessment, and those who pass are certified, so it is a standardized. I believe only one or two large retail sector people have actually employed people with certification from a sector skill council. But if you do not institutionalize this, where does the standard come in? So I think after this conference, everyone should decide, A, that you will only accept people who are certified by the sector skill council so that they get branded here and they get branded internationally. Am I correct? Do you all think it is this idea should work? Unless until you, someone said, what is the legitimacy of this certification? I said, do you want the government to come with a law? Or would you want the industry to do it themselves? So if the industry decides, this is my qualification I require, this is the training I require, and this is the outcome which I am going to employ, why do you want the government to get in? Why can't you decide, and we will standardize the certification, and that certification across board would be recognized. So let's get going in a direction which will absolutely give across the country, and let not government get into it. I have a ministry in Delhi which is not a part of Udyog Bhavan or Krishi Bhavan. It is located somewhere out without a CISF constabulary guarding me. So all of you are welcome to come there. You will not be able to have a problem. It's like a private arm. And I think I'm privileged to run a department, sorry, a ministry, which looks like a private body, a corporate body. And possibly this is the vision which the Prime Minister has. I have my own issues, as I said. But I'm still struggling to say that this is one sector which would meet the aspirations of Indian youth. And next 5 years, the most magnificent work which would have had happened under the pioneering leadership of the Prime Minister would be the skill development and entrepreneurship. If you invite me next time, I'll talk about entrepreneurship. Thank you very much.